Just a reminder, as we get ready to start the service, I would invite you to check out your cell phones and make sure that they are off or on vibrate, and maybe even airplane mode, so that those who join us online will have the full service. Welcome, in the name of Jesus the Savior, who died and was raised to new life by the grace of God. We are gathered here to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our sister Brandi, and to give thanks for her life, to commend her to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. I invite you to join me in singing On Eagle's Wings.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Brandi. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Illumine our lives so we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. At this time, I invite Brandi's mother, Susan Small, to come up.
I'd like to thank all of you today who have gathered to celebrate my daughter's life, for family and friends, and those who are here to support us. I want to share a few memories and stories from her life. Brandi's life was taken away from us too early, and while I mourn my daughter's absence, I am filled with regrets for the missed opportunities that remained in her future. But I do want to rejoice and share these memories and celebrate her wonderful accomplishments as well. This may be a little bit difficult for me, but I'm going to use my daughter's words, which I heard many times in the last few months regarding her journey with cancer, and that is, I got this. I got this. Some of the overall things you need to know about Brandi. She was a beautiful woman inside and out. Looking at all the pictures we've displayed out there, you will notice that she's always smiling. She never took a bad picture. She was easygoing from birth, and yet she was strong in her life's journey. She was an accomplished athlete, a good student, an animal lover, a dedicated wife and mother. She was selfless, putting others and their needs before herself. I'm going to go through some favorite memories. Our first road trip was a long trip to Montana to meet the Small family. And this was back in the day. Brandi was about 3, her older brother about 6. We could throw a mattress in the back of the station wagon. It was still legal, and the kids could sleep, and the adults could drive all night long. In Brandi's words throughout this trip, she was going to Mamatana, because she couldn't say Montana, and she was going to eat hangovers when she got there. It was a great trip, despite a long drive. A major part of her life was swimming. She displayed unsurpassed dedication and dominant part of her life. She started swim lessons around 4 to 5 years of age, quickly developed a love for the water, and by the age of 7, she was swimming with the Iowa City Swim Club, which was a USA swimming organization. This became her dedicated sport for literally the next 10 years. A year-round program with indoor and outdoor season, she spent literally thousands of hours in the pool. Her life was centered around swimming, often practices 6 days a week. We had meets on weekends throughout the entire year. And there was a core of swimmers and moms who frequently traveled together through Iowa, Nebraska, Illinois, Minnesota on a regular basis for swim meets. I first experienced Omaha because of swimming. To this day, I remember the hotels and restaurants we frequented, but probably couldn't locate the pools, surprisingly, where they swam. Favorite restaurants here were Fuddruckers and Olive Garden. And our children often entertained and embarrassed us by balancing spoons on their nose while waiting for their food to arrive. The Omaha landmark for all of our navigation was the corner of 72nd and Dodge. I would have never guessed that Brandi would be a resident of Omaha for many years and eventually live so close to this very spot. One of her highlights living in Omaha was when they began hosting the Olympic swim trials. This was a major thing for her. She was very excited to go watch the people that she so admired and the athletes that she admired compete to qualify for the Olympics. I accompanied her on several of the sessions, and at one point in time, we were thrilled to be walking across the street with Michael Phelps's mother. If you don't know Michael Phelps, he was one of the top swimmers. And we managed to take a picture with his mom and I, and it's a very cherished photo at this time. During the entire rest of her life, Brandi never, ever lost her love of swimming and could use this as recreation at any point for her. High school and beyond. Brandi enjoyed high school with many friends. She played the flute in marching band. She swam for the high school swim team, as well as continued to swim with her local swim club. She found time to work at Hy-Vee. Dogs were always part of our family, but surprisingly, horses were always a passion. I was really shocked when I looked through all the photos for the last month or so, and kind of going, well, I wonder if I've forgotten more than I remember, because I don't know when she went to horse camp. You just kind of learn things, and certain things, I guess, you forget. So, but horses were a passion of hers, and as she got into high school and things were a little different, she had more independence, she had a lot more opportunities to ride at a local stable that hadn't been available for her before. As a senior, Brandi wanted to become a veterinarian, and she was accepted to Iowa State for her undergraduate. However, a good Air Force recruiter must have piqued her interest, and suddenly we found her enlisting in the Air Force instead of starting college. Brandi proudly served her 4 years in the Air Force, and after basic training, she was stationed at Whiteman Air Force Base in Missouri, proud to be a crewman on the B-2 bomber. Although I regret we didn't get to see her a lot during those 4 years. After her active military service ended in 2000, she moved to Omaha permanently, and within the next 2 years, she married Wade Horner and gave birth to her first child, Cameron. We were all so excited. She was so excited when he was born. We couldn't wait to meet the first grandchild, and he certainly did not disappoint. Brandi then also fulfilled during this time her dream of owning her own horse, and she loved to spend time riding and sometimes took Cameron with her. Eventually, life brought relationship changes, but she remained a dedicated mom, continued her path toward a college degree while continuing to work. She graduated in 2006 from Bellevue with a degree in human resources. When she finally got ready to start dating again, she decided to use a dating app. Thanks to Match.com, she connected with Brandon in May of 2007. I remember her being so excited she couldn't stop talking about him. So happy for both of them when they married in 2011. In 2012, they welcomed their son, Landon. They become a family, then, of yours, mine, and ours. This was a big commitment, not always smooth sailing, but they definitely met the challenge of raising three boys. They could talk for hours at a time, and I always deeply admired their level of communication that they had. In 2020, Brandon and Brandi suddenly announced they were buying a house at the Lake of the Ozarks. They talked about the lake continuously ever since they had attended a family reunion there, but I think they really caught parents off guard when they decided that they were going to make this big move. Retrospectively, it was one of the best moves that they could have made. They worked hard to get all their finances in order, put lots of time and effort into getting their home ready to sell in Omaha, quit their jobs, were confident all would be well. They were right. Everything fell together like a perfect puzzle. They were so happy, enjoyed their life and home at the lake. So thankful they took this chance, because the dream was about to change 8 months after the move, when Brandi was diagnosed with lung cancer. absolutely devastating news to the entire family, and their lives were turned upside down. The life they loved so much was now going to change again. Brandi began some radiation treatments in Missouri, and everything that they had done less than a year before was put in reverse. They were moving back to Omaha. Given all they were going through emotionally, physically, they remained positive and did what they had to do. It was great to have them back close to family and under good medical care when they were back in Omaha. They found a great home for themselves, resumed camping back at Cottonwood, where they had enjoyed camping before. And of course, we can't ever forget the pets with Brandi. She was such a pet lover, so it didn't matter. 3 cats, 2 dogs, 1 guinea pig, plenty of room for more. So pretty soon it was a horse. The next thing it was a big dog. The next thing it was another guinea pig. She never stopped loving the animals, and there was always enough love to go around. When Christmas 2021 came, chemo treatments had begun. Brandi said that she did not want gifts, she wanted experiences. As an entire family set out to plan a Hawaiian vacation for January of 22. It was probably a long shot, but for a while it kept Brandi looking forward beyond her treatments. In March, she finished a chemo treatment, and I thought we should take a girl's trip to Minneapolis, the Mall of America. Brandi, her sister-in-law, Jill, and I set out for a long weekend right before her 44th birthday. We shopped, we laughed, we ate, we shared stories. Brandi read about a place called Duck Donuts in the mall, and of course we had to go there for breakfast donuts. We were in line before they even opened, and it did not disappoint. Brandi never did have a strong interest in shopping for herself, but she did buy a pair of shoes on this journey. And the last day, we walked into a candy store that had everything imaginable, and she spotted this guy, known as a nerd. And she walked by it multiple times, and she kept going back, and it made her smile. And before long, she was buying it out the door, and he was coming home to Omaha. I hope this makes some of you smile today, knowing that this is the kind of thing that she loved the best. The last thing before we left the mall was to go to those amusement rides, if any of you have been there. Brandi couldn't stop talking about roller coaster, because she hadn't been on one for a long time, and I think she really feared that she would never ride another roller coaster for many reasons. But the joy in her face was unbelievable when we went on that roller coaster. She then joined her sister-in-law, a little reluctant to join her on the ride, to these elevated swings, but they had a good time. Our last stop was to the log water ride up there. We waited nearly an hour in line. I agreed to take the front seat in case everybody was going to get wet. It was going to hopefully be me to take it for the team. We made it through, and Brandi had a sparkle in her eyes, and they both sat and laughed at my soaked clothing, and I was extremely wet. We found a great local restaurant that evening and had a casual dinner. Sunday morning, we all parted ways to go back, myself to Iowa, her sister-in-law to Madison, Wisconsin, and Brandi to Omaha. At that point, I was at least very thankful that we were able to complete that experience. So I hope that my words and stories have helped you see the incredible individual we have lost. I believe we're just beginning to realize how truly important Brandi was in our lives. She taught me many things, most of all, courage. She will remain in our memories and hearts forever. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan, for your courage and for sharing a little bit and a piece of Brandi's life with us. At this point in time, we are ready to move into some words of scripture and hope that God has given us. In these scriptures, you will find a God who is in charge and a God who leads us through. The first one is from Ecclesiastes 3, 1 through 15. For everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds. Yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nothing, nor anything taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. That which is already has been. That which is to be already is. And God seeks out what has gone by. Our second reading for today comes from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. And a reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. So we do not lose heart, even though our outer nature is wasting away. Our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. And our gospel reading for today comes from John chapter 14, when Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to Jesus, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Well, grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today we are gathered together to mourn the loss of Brandi. And we gather here with Brandon and their children, Mason and Cameron and Landon, along with her parents and his parents, the many siblings on both sides, and the family and friends who have gathered here to mourn with you, to love with you, to support you. But today we also come to remember her life, her strong life, her courage, her strength with us, and also to celebrate Brandi's life, that she now lives in Christ. To get started, I thought I'd start by sharing just a little bit more about who Brandi was with us here. According to Brandi's father, Bill, even as a kid, Brandi seemed to have absolutely no fear. She was a bit of a daredevil, and she was willing to do and try new things, hence the great excitement even still on a roller coaster. And sometimes the things that she would try, she would be willing to try them even before her older brother was necessarily ready to try them himself. And Brandi as a person was upbeat and positive, and she truly believed that the best was going to happen if she was given two options. And although Brandi throughout her life saw lots of good and bad times come and go, this never changed her outlook. Things were always going to be okay. And she was reassuring her family, as her mom said, telling them not to worry. It was going to be okay. She's got this. A matter of fact, this is the demeanor of Brandi with a lot of things. She was indeed a hard worker, an organizer, and a fixer. This is probably why she got involved with competitive swimming at such a young age, because she had dreams. She was going to do good things. But when an injury to her shoulder kind of knocked out her ability to continue going farther in high school in competitive swimming, she moved right on to the next adventure. That perhaps being her being a mechanic in the Air Force for B-2 bombers. She took real pride in all of her work. And that was in the Air Force with her work with ConAgra. She was always making sure that things were organized and happening the way they were supposed to. And even when it came time to raising and caring for her family, she was highly organized. A matter of fact, I was told about the whiteboard door that was so impressive. It had the whole week, everything one would need for the week on the grocery list. And together, her and Brandon would go and take care of it. And it had all of the events and things that were important that were happening that week. And she also loved raising and caring, in my opinion, for as many animals as Brandon would let her have. She truly had a passion for that. And it was shared with me, even when Cameron was little, they would make trips to the Humane Society just to check out what the animals were there. And while Brandy was indeed very strong and independent, she and Brandon did so many things together. A matter of fact, I think they did everything together. And they weren't afraid to try out new things and to make sure that they were getting their moments of enjoyment out of life. A matter of fact, when I was talking to Brandon, he says they loved to camp. So much so that he figured that in the last 5 years or so, they went camping absolutely every weekend they could, which, being in a place where there's winter, he figures that was about 14 to 25 weekends out of 52. And they were currently on their fifth camper. It was a true joy and pleasure, and a place where they met many of friends. And their sense of dreaming and timing, even when doubted by others, as Susan pointed out, it turned out, when all of your parents frowned against your decisions, you two said, we'll be fine. We're going to make it. We want to do this. And you lived big, and you dreamed, and you went to the Ozarks, and you sought those new adventures. And even as COVID came in, you were fine. You had your swimming. You had all the things that you loved right there with you, and you had the best times of your lives. An extended vacation, so to speak, of about 8 months. The truth is, had you known the timing or what was going to come, no one could imagine a better way for you to have chosen than the path that you did of time with one another. And even in the throes of Brandy suddenly discovering she had stage 4 cancer, and her fighting with all of her might, Brandy still held on to her positivity, her courage. And she never complained or wanted her illness to be the main focus of everyone around her. Instead, she wanted it to be on celebrating and going to the next best thing and what was going on. And indeed, she fought valiantly to the end, is with us now, and has gone on ahead of us to prepare our heavenly place for us. The place where Jesus told his disciples, and he tells us, he has gone ahead of us, and he will come back, and he will bring us home. Thanks be to God that according to Scripture, this is now where we have been. We have seen the light of Christ shining through Brandy's light. Here on earth, it was a fragile life, as if a clay jar, but it was indeed filled with the light and life that God placed in her, a temporary treasure in which we found great enjoyment and love and companionship in God. This life of Brandy was a gift from God, a gift of love that promises no matter what, that is still where God is going to hold us, in love. In John 3:16, Jesus said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son so that all who believe in him may not perish, but have eternal life." Brandy knew this and believed this. And in many ways, Brandy lived as Jesus told his disciples that they were to live in their temporary bodies as well. He said, when he knew he was going to leave, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Dear friends, losing a loved one is always hard. But losing someone who is so young, who seemed to have so much love and life and promise ahead of her, well, that's even harder. Jesus knew this to be true, as this is about the way his life went too. And he knew that in hard times, we needed words and we needed comfort. So God offers a peace that surpasses all understanding, a peace that promises that no matter where we are going or what we are going through, God isn't going to leave us. God is going to hold us, and God is going to deliver us right back to him in new life. That is our home. The love and life that our bodies, our shell of a body, fill. We might suffer because this life is only temporary, and death will indeed find us all. And Paul talked about that in Corinthians when he said, even though our outer nature is wasting away, even though our human bodies are failing, our inner nature, our life and our life with God is being renewed day by day. This is the love and the hope and the promise that we have through Jesus that God proclaimed upon our heads in the waters of baptism, that we were God's forever. And because of God's love, even though death is a part of every story of life, the life and light that we have in these fragile bodies does not die. Instead, it returns to God. For Paul writes, "For this momentary affliction is preparing us for the eternal weight of glory beyond measure." This is where we go and enter what we cannot see, that of eternity. Just as Jesus himself was resurrected from the dead and ascended into heaven, there too we know beyond our eyesight is our forever home. So in thinking about this holy and powerful promise of life everlasting that has been given to us by God. There is no reason for us not to make the most of the time that we have here on earth, and also to do our part, to use the gifts we've been given, as Brandi used her organizational skills and her positivity to make sure that light shines from our life. And it also means that instead of us saying to ourselves and perhaps to those around us, it's okay, don't worry, I've got this, God invites us to lean in, to trust in God's loving embrace to hold us with hope and promise and trust that no matter what is to come, we need not worry. We need not be afraid. God has got us. God is with us. And there is no place that we could even imagine going where God hasn't already been. God leads the way. This is the peace and promise that Christ comes and brings to us. All who believe, do not let your hearts be troubled. God's got Brandi. God is with us now and always will be. And no matter what was or is or will be to come, it is God who will lead us forward, who will hold on to us and give us courage and strength when we don't think we have it ourselves. And dear friends, with the help of God, we can do this, whatever may come. For God is with us, God's got Brandi, and God's got us, now and forever. Amen. At this time, I invite you to sing with us, "How Small Our Span of Life."
Thank you.
At this time, I invite you to join in professing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace, God of mercy. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share with new life in Christ, God of mercy. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. At this time, let us commend Brandi to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Brandi. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Our service is about to conclude, but before we do, I just wanted to make an announcement of how things will go when we proceed from here. As we end, Brandon and the family have provided a meal with the help of Lord of Love that they wish to invite all of you to come and partake in. And that will be, if you just follow down this hallway, you'll be right in line and you can go to the tables and eat. But before we do, I'd like to offer a word of blessing upon our leaving this place. Good and gracious God of love, as we think about Brandi, and as we continue to remember stories of her life with us and the light and love that she shared with us. We pray that your light and love would be with us, that it would watch over us as we go from this place, that it would bless the food we are about to eat, and that the light and love that shines so brightly through Brandi's life would go with us, that we would hold on to it and trust that, God, you got this, you got us, and it's gonna be okay because you hold our forever home. And in this, we place our trust. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us go forth in peace.